Hello, my dear listener. I do believe that you are all right. Thank God for this beautiful day. This is Morningstar Radio, the voice of hope, broadcasting from Mikocheni B, Dar es Salaam. The program now is Divine Service. Please welcome and be ready to partake of today's blessings. After this instrumental music, a call to worship will follow, then a word of prayer, and finally the spoken word. Please stay tuned.
Hello there. What a privilege it is today for us to be here again together through media to worship our Heavenly Father, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the Creator of the heaven and earth. I invite each one of you to join us as we worship Him today in this hour. May I invite each one of us to just bow our heads as we call upon the name of the Lord. Almighty Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great privilege we have of coming together again to worship you in this hour. We thank you for the blessings of life that you have given us, which we shall not take for granted, but it's your care that you have kept us alive to this moment, given us good health, given us a moment of worshiping you. We therefore come before your presence this day again in jubilation, in praise of your holy name, calling upon you, our Heavenly Father, to be with us as we come to worship you at this hour. We submit ourselves into your care, and we pray, Heavenly Father, that your angels will be with each one of us as we gather together through these channels to call upon your name and to worship you. I pray for our brothers and sisters, wherever they are, listening to your word. May the preacher of the hour be lifted upon the throne, and that you will fill him with your Holy Spirit, and that through him you will speak to every soul listening to you at this hour. We pray, Father, that you will bless our souls. And as we come together, may you heal us, not only of our physical maladies, but heal us spiritually. We need you now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. There is a place of quiet rest.
There is a place of quiet rest
near to the heart of God. A place where sin cannot molest. Near to the heart of God. Oh Jesus, blessed Redeemer. Sent from the heart of God. Hold us who wait before thee. Near to the heart of God. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this is a solemn moment in which we should humble ourselves in entirety to listen to the Word of God. For those of you who have just tuned in, this is Morningstar Radio, the voice of hope to all people, and my name is Evangelist Simon Jackson Mukangara to bring you today's message. Our subject today is called Young Men in Christ. Young Men in Christ. Where do I get the idea of these young men? Please turn your Bible with you to the book of 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We're going to read verses 13 and 14 from where our subject is taken and developed. 1 John chapter 2, verse 13 and 14 says,
I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one.
Because you have done what?
Because ye have overcome the wicked one.
Verse 14.
I have written unto you fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one.
Come up again on young men.
I have written unto you young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abideth in you, and ye have overcome the wicked one.
Amen. Amen. I write you, young men, because you've overcome the wicked one. I've written to you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Wonderful. Who are these young men in the Lord? Are they young in age or young in grace? And how do you know them? Are you one of them? Let us pray. Our Father and our God, this is your day and your moment, Lord. Your sons and daughters are waiting to be taught by your Holy Spirit on this important subject regarding people who are considered young, people who are strong, people who have overcome the wicked one, people in whose hearts and mind abides your word. We are teachable, Lord. Take over now and speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Beloved, John's message to the young man starts by saying, I write. And then, I've written. You see, he's writing. His whole heart is in it. And he cannot help saying that. He himself is earnestly writing to those whom he loves so well. But he has scarcely penned the line before he feels that he must alter that present tense and set it in the past under the form of, I have written. He knows that he must soon be gone from them and be numbered with those who were, but are not among the living men. These words then are the language of a father in Israel, still among his children. For what I shall have to say at this time, fairly flowing from the text, shall come to you as Christ's word from his favored disciple John. You will attach the more importance to it, and it will do your hearts more good. Lifting his head from that dear bosom, John whispers, I write to you, young man. And looking down from that favored place, which he now occupies so near to the throne of the Lamb, he looks over the battlements of heaven upon us, and cries, I have written to you, young man. Oh, beloved, in the Christian church, there is an order of Christians who have grown so much that they can no longer be called babies in grace, but yet they are not so far matured that they can be exactly called fathers. These, who form the middle class of the spiritual-minded, are styled young men. Understand that the apostle is not writing here to any according to their bodily age. No, do not mislead yourselves, beloved. John is using human age as a metaphor and figure for representing growth in the spiritual life. Age, according to the flesh, often differs much from the condition of the spirit. Many old men are still no more than babies in grace. Some children in years are even now young men in grace, while not a few young men are fathers in the church while young in years. God has endowed certain of his servants with great grace and made them mature in their youth. Such were Joseph, Samuel, David, Josiah, and Timothy. It is not age according to the family register that we are now to speak about, but age according to the Lamb's Book of Life. Beloved, grace is a matter of growth, and hence we have among us babies, young men, and fathers whose position is not reckoned according to this fleeting, dying life, but according to that eternal life which has been wrought in them of the Spirit of God. It is a great mercy when young men in the natural sense are also young men in the spiritual sense, and I'm glad that it is largely so in our church. The fathers among us need not be ashamed of their spiritual seed. My dear hearers, in speaking to young men in Christ, I'm speaking to a numerous body of Christians among ourselves who make up a very efficient part of the army of Christ in this region, and I would ask them not to be either so modest or so proud as to decline to be thus classed. You are no longer weaklings. Do not therefore count yourselves mere babies, lest you plead exemption from hard service. You are hardly yet mature enough to rank with the fathers, so do not forget the duties of your real place under cover of aspiring to another. It is honor enough to be in Christ, and certainly it is no small thing to be in spiritual things, a man in the prime of life. These young men are not babies. They have been in Christ too long for that. They are no longer novices to whom the Lord's house is strange. They have been born unto God probably now for years. The things which they hoped for at first, they have to a large extent realized. They know now what once they could not understand. They are not now confined to milky diet. They can eat meat and digest it well. They have discernment, having had their senses exercised by reason of use, so that they are not so liable to be misled as they were in their infancy. And while they have been longer in the way, so also have they now grown stronger in the way. It is not a weak and timorous faith which they now possess. In fact, they believe firmly and stoutly, and are able to do better, for the faith once delivered to the saints, they are strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. They are wiser now than they used to be. When they were children, they knew enough to save them, for they knew the Father, and that was blessed knowledge. But now they know far more of the Word of God, which abides in them through their earnest, prayerful, believing reception of it. Now they have a clearer idea of the breadth and length and depth and height of the work of redemption, for they have been taught of God. They even venture to enjoy the deep things of God. And the covenant is by no means an unknown thing among them. They have been under the blessed teaching of the Spirit of God, and from Him they have received an unction, so that they know all things. In knowledge, they are no more children, but men in Christ Jesus. Thus, they are distinguished from the first class, which comprehends the babies in Christ. Now, these young men are not yet fathers because they are not yet so established, not yet so confirmed, and settled as the fathers are, who know what they believe and know it with a certainty of full assurance which nothing can shake. They have not yet had the experience of fathers, and consequently have not all their prudence and foresight. As a matter of fact, they are richer in zeal than in judgment. They have not yet acquired the nursing faculty so precious in the church as the product of growth, experience, maturity, and affection. They are going on to that, and in a short time they will have reached it, but as yet they have other work to do more suitable to their vigor. And so, do not suppose that when we say they are not to be called fathers, that they are not therefore very valuable to the community. No. You see, in some senses they are quite equal to the fathers, and in one or two respects they may even be superior to them. Follow me now. The fathers are for contemplation. They study deep and see far, and so they have known Him that is from the beginning. But a measure of their energy for action may have gone through stress of years. These young men are born to fight. They are the militia of the church. They have to contend for her faith and to extend the Redeemer's kingdom. They should do so, for they are strong. This is their lot, and may the Lord help them to fulfill their calling. These must for years to come be our active spirits. They are our strength and our hope. The fathers must soon go off the stage, and their maturity in grace shows that they are ready for glory. And it is not God's way to keep His stalks of corn in the field when once they are fully ripe for the garner. Perfect men shall be gathered up with the perfect and shall enter into their proper sphere. The fathers, therefore, must soon be gone, and when they are gone, to whom are we to look for a succession but to these young men? We hope to have them for many years with us, valiant for the truth, steadfast in the faith, ripening in spirit, and growingly made meet to take their seats among the glorified saints above. Judge then, dear brethren and dear sisters, whether you are fairly to be ranked among the young men. Have no regard to the matter of sex, for there is neither male nor female in Christ Jesus. Judge whether you be fit to be ranked among those whose full-grown and vigorous life entitles them to stand among the effectives of the church, the vigorous manhood of the seed of Israel. To such I speak, beloved, and may God bless His word.
Amen.
Now, the first thing that John notes about these young men is the possession of their strength. For he says, I've written to you, young men, because you are strong. Let's talk about this strength. These Christians of the middle class are emphatically strong. This does not imply that any measure of spiritual strength was in them by nature, no. For the Apostle Paul clearly puts it otherwise concerning our natural state. He says, when we were yet without strength, Christ died for the ungodly. So that, by nature, we are without strength to do anything that is good and right. We are strong as a wild bull to dash headlong into everything that is evil. Strong as a lion to fight all that is good and godlike. But for all spiritual things and holy things, we are utterly infirm and incapable. Yes, we are as dead men until God through the Holy Spirit deals with us. Neither does the apostle here at all allude to the strength of the body in young men. For in a spiritual sense, beloved, this is rather their weakness than their strength. Follow me. The man who is strong in the flesh is too often, for that very reason, strongly tempted to sins of the flesh. And hence, the apostle bids his young friend, saying, flee youthful lusts. Whenever you read the life of Samson, you may thank God you had not Samson's sinews. Or else, it is more than probable that you would have had Samson's passions, and they might have mastered you as they mastered him. The time of life in which a young man is found is full of perils, and so is the spiritual condition of which it is the type. The young man might almost wish that it were with him as with the older man, in whom the forces of the flesh have declined, for though age brings with it many infirmities, it also has its gain in the abatement of the passions. So you see, the young man cannot reckon upon vigor of the flesh as contributing towards real strength, which you are talking about. He is rather to ask for more strength from on high, lest the animal vigor that is within him should drag down his spirit. He is glad to be in robust health, that he may bear much toil in the Lord's cause, but he is not proud of it, for he remembers that the Lord delights not in the strength of the horse and takes not pleasure in the legs of a man. These young men in grace are strong, first of all, in faith, according to the exhortation, be strong, fear not. They have known the Lord now for some time, and they have enjoyed that perfect peace which comes of forgiven sin. They have marked the work of the Spirit within themselves, and they know that it is no delusion, but a divine change. And now they not only believe in Christ, but they know that they believe in Him. They know whom they have believed, and they are persuaded that He is able to keep that which they have committed to Him. That faith, which was once a healing touch, has now become a satisfying embrace. That enjoyment which was once a sip has now become a drought, quenching all thirst. Yes, and that which was once a drought has become an immersion into the river of God, which is full of water. They have plunged into the river of life and find waters to swim in. Oh dear, what a mess it is to be strong in this fashion. Let him that is strong take heed that he glory only in the Lord, who is his righteousness and strength. But in him and his strength, he may indeed make his boast and defy the armies of the aliens. What says Paul? He says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. My brethren and my sisters, take good heed that you never lose this strength. Pray God that you may never sin so as to lose it. Pray God that you may never backslide so as to lose it. Pray God that you may never grieve the Spirit so as to lose it. For I reckon that to be endowed with power from on high and to be strong in faith, giving glory to God, is the truest glory and majesty of our manhood, and that we are sad to lose it or even to defeat it. Amen. Oh dear, how I pray that all Christians were so much advanced as to enter the enlisted battalion of the Lord's young men. This strength makes a man strong to endure. He is a sufferer, yes, but mark how patient he is. He is a loser in business, yes, and he has a hard task to earn his daily bread, yes, but he never complains. He has learned in every state to be content. He is persecuted, yes, but he is not distressed thereby. Men revile him, yes, but he is not moved from the even tenor of his way. He grows careless alike of flattery and calumny. So long as he can please God, he cares not to displease men. He dwells on high and lives above the smoke of human opinion. He bears and forbears. He bows his neck to the yoke and his shoulders to the burden and his fellowship with Christ in his sufferings. Blessed then is that man who is so strong that he never complains of his trials, never whimpers and frets because he is made to share in the humiliations and griefs of his covenant head. He expected to bear the cross when he became a follower of the crucified and is not now made weary amid faint when it presses upon him. It is a fair sight to see young Isaac bearing the wood for the sacrifice, young Joseph bearing the fetters in prison with holy joy, young Samson carrying away the gates of Gaza and bars and all, and young David praising God with his harp, though Saul is feeling for his javelin. Such are the exploits of the young men who count it all joy when they fall into manifold trials for Christ's sake. O young man, be strong. Strong as an iron column which bears the full stress of the building and is not moved. This strength shows itself next in laboring for Christ. The young man in Christ is a great worker. He has so much strength that he cannot sit still. He would be ashamed to leave the burden and hate the day to be borne by others. He is up and at it according to his calling and ability. He has asked his Lord as a favor to give him something to do. His prayer has been, Lord, show what you would have me to do. And having received an answer, he is found in the vineyard trenching the soil, removing the weeds, pruning the vines, and attending to such labors as the seasons demand. His master has said to him, feed my sheep and feed my lambs. And therefore, you shall see him through the livelong day and far into the night, watching over the flock which is committed to him. In all this toil, he greatly rejoices, for he is strong. He can run and not be weary. He can walk and not faint. For he says, by my God, have I leaped over a wall. Nothing is hard to him, or if it be, he remembers that the diamond cuts the diamond, and so he sets a harder thing against a hard thing, and by a firm and stern resolution, he overcomes. That which ought to be done, he declares, shall be done in the power of God, and it is accomplished. Blessed is the church that has a quiver full of these. She shall speak with the adversaries in the gate. These are the men who work our reformations, beloved. These are the men who conduct our missions. These are the men who launch out into the deep for Christ. They make the vanguard of the host of God and largely compose the main body of her forces. I trust our church has many such. May they yet be multiplied and increased among us, that we may never lack for choice soldiers of the cross, able to lead on the hosts of God. So also are these young men strong to resist attack. Follow me. They are assaulted, yes, but they carry with them the shield of faith wherewith they quench the fiery darts of the enemy. Wherever they go, if they meet with other tempted ones, they spring to the front to espouse their cause. They are ready in the day of battle to meet attacks upon the faith with the sword of the Spirit. They will yield no point of faith, but defend the truth at all hazards. Clad in the panoply of truth, they meet no deadly wound, for by grace they are so preserved that the wicked one touches them not. They resist temptation and are unharmed in the midst of peril. Do you want a specimen? I'll give you. Look at Joseph. Where 10,000 would have fallen, he stands in snow-white purity. Joseph, as contrasted with David, is an instance of how a young man may bring greater glory to God than an old man when assailed by a kindred temptation. Joseph is but young, and the temptation forces itself upon him while he is in the path of duty. He is alone with his temptress, and no one need know the sin if it be committed. On the other hand, if he refuses, shame and possibly death may await him through the calumny of his offended mistress. Yet, young Joseph Bravery resists the assault and overcomes the wicked one.
Amen.
He is a bright contrast to the older man, the father of Israel, who went out of his way to compass an evil deed and committed crime in order to fulfill his foul desire, David. From this case, beloved, we learn then that neither years, nor knowledge, nor experience can preserve any of us from sin. But old and young must be kept by the power of God, or else they will be overthrown by the tempter. Furthermore, these young men are not only strong for resistance, but they are strong for attack. They carry the war into the enemy's territory. If there is anything to be done, they are like Jonathan and his armor bearer, eager for the fray. These are very zealous for the Lord of hosts and are prompt to undertake toil and travail for Jesus' sake. These young men smite down error and set up truth. These young men believe great things. These young men attempt great things. These young men expect great things, and the Lord is with them. One of them shall chase 1,000, and two put 10,000 to flight. So have I shown you, my dear friends, my dear listeners, what these young men are, and that is, they are strong, strong to believe, strong to suffer, strong to do, strong to resist, and strong to attack. May the companies of these go in and out among us to fight the Lord's battles, for to this end is the Lord girded them with strength.
Amen.
That is number one, their possession of strength. Now let us come to number two. Here we shall notice their need of strength. For John says, "You are strong and you have overcome the wicked one." Beloved, between the lines of the text, I read the fact that young men who are strong must expect to be attacked. This also follows from a rule of divine economy. Whenever God lays up stores, it is because there will be need of them. When Egypt's granaries were full with the supply of 7 years of plenty, one might have been sure that 7 years of famine were about to come. So it is that whenever a man is strong, it is because he has stern work to do. For as the Israelites of old never had an ounce or gram of manna left over till morning, except that which bred worms and stank, so there never will be a Christian that is a pennyworth of grace left over from his daily requirements. If you are weak, you shall have no trial happen to you, but such as common to men. But if you are strong, rest assured, my friend, that trials, many and heavy, are awaiting you. Every sinew in the arm of faith will have to be tested. Every single weapon given out of the armory of God will be called for in the conflict. Christian soldiering is no piece of military pastime. It is no proud parade. It means hard fighting from the day of enlistment to the day of reward. The strong young man may rest assured then that he has no force to spend in display, no energy which he may use in vaporing and vainglory. As a matter of fact, there is a heavy burden for the strong shoulder and a fierce fight for the trained hand. But you may probably ask, Evangelist, why does Satan attack this class of men most? I reckon, first, because Satan is not always sure that the babies in grace are in grace. And therefore, he does not always attack beginners. But when they are sufficiently developed to make him see who and what they are, then he arouses his wrath. Those who have escaped from him, he will weary and worry to the utmost of his power. Now one may ask whether Satan knows our thoughts. Of course he does not, but God does.
Amen.
You see, beloved, Satan pretty surely guesses at them from our actions and our words, and even from manifestations upon our countenances. But it is the Lord alone, God the Almighty, who knows the thoughts of men immediately and by themselves. Satan is an old hand at studying human nature. He has been 6,000 years watching and tempting men and women, and therefore he is full of cunning, but yet he is not omniscient. And therefore he thinks such and such a person is so little in grace that perhaps he is not in grace at all. So he lets him alone. But as soon as ever it is certain that the man is of the royal seed, then the devil is at him. I do not know whether our Lord was ever tempted at Nazareth while he was yet in his obscurity. But the moment he was baptized and the Spirit of God came upon him, the Bible says he was taken into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. So if you become an avowed servant of God, beloved, do not think the conflict is over. As a matter of fact, it is then that the battle begins. Put that in your mind.
Right.
Straight from the waters of baptism, it may be you will have to go into such a wilderness and such a conflict as you never knew before. Satan knows that young men in grace can do his kingdom great harm. And therefore, he would willingly slay them early in the day, as the Egyptian Pharaoh wished to kill all the male children of Israel. My brethren and my sisters, you are strong to overthrow Satan's kingdom, and therefore, you need not marvel that he desires to overthrow you. I think it is right that young men should endure hardness, for else they might become proud. You see, it is hard to hide pride from men. Full of strength, full of courage, full of patience, full of zeal, such men are ready enough and ripe enough to believe the wicked one when he whispers that they are perfect. And therefore, trial is always sent to keep them out of that grievous snare of the evil one. Let me make a strange statement here. The devil is used by God as a householder might employ a scullion to clean his pots and kettles. Listen to me. The devil tempts the saint. And what happens? The saint sees his inward depravity and is no longer able to boast. The devil thinks he is going to destroy the man of God, but God is making the temptation work for the believer's eternal good. That is what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Listen, no temptation ever overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape, so that you may be able to bear it. Listen, my dear friend. Here we are told God does not tempt us, yes, but he allows the devil to tempt you. Let us consider the case of Job. In Job chapter 1, verses 7 to 12, the Bible says, the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Then Satan answered the Lord, saying, "I come from roaming through the earth and going back and forth in it." Then the Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There's no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil." Oh, beloved, can you place your name in Job's position and follow this story intelligently? Listen now, Satan responding to God about this man, Job. He asks God, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has? You have blessed the work of his hands, so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. But stretch out your hand and strike everything he has, and he will surely curse you to your face." What does the Lord say? The Lord says to Satan, "Very well." Very well. Think of it. God saying to Satan, "Very well then. Everything he has is in your hands." What is God saying here? You see, beloved, when he says to Satan, "Very well then, everything he has is in your hands," he simply tells you and I that he can allow and use Satan to tempt us, but he cannot allow Satan to tempt us beyond what we are able. And that's why, in the very case of Job, in the first round of temptation, God says to Satan, "But on the man himself, do not lay a finger."
Amen.
Oh, beloved. We see here then, Satan going out from the presence of the Lord to go where? To go to Job. To do what? To tempt him. Then comes the second round, Job chapter 2. When you read verses 3 to 7, the Lord says to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil, and still maintains his integrity, though you incited me against him to ruin him without any reason." Oh, beloved, watch out. You are no exception from Job. God may still allow Satan to incite him to ruin you without any reason. But one good thing is, God, who knows the end from the beginning, knows well that when Satan strikes at you, he can only strengthen you in your faith to God instead of defeating you. And even when you are afflicted, the Lord is with you. He has not left you or forsaken you. And while the devil is up against you, remember, God has already said to him, very well then, he is in your hands, but you must spare his life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Now, beloved, back to our topic on the young men who were given strength by God to overcome the devil, the wicked one. In this scenario, and in comparative terms, it is far better to have Beelzebub, the god of flies, pestering you than to become fly-blown with the notions of your own excellence. This notion of your own excellence is nothing but pride, and pride will take you to hell. Besides, brethren, not only might this young man be a prey to pride, but certainly would not bring the glory to God untried than he brings to him when he overcomes temptation. I've given you the story of Job up to the time when he is tempted. So don't say we've no story to read. Job's story was written for our teaching, for our correction, and for our instruction in righteousness. Had it not been for his temptation, there would be nothing worthy of record, only that his flocks and herds continued to multiply, that another child was born, and so forth. Oh, beloved, there is no history to a nation when everything goes well. And it is so with a believer. But when trials come, and the man plays the man, and is valiant for God against the arch enemy, I tell you, I hear a voice from heaven saying, right, now you shall have history. History that will glorify God. It is but right that those who are young men in Christ should endure conflicts that they may bring honor to their Father, their Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit who dwells in them. Besides, it prepares them for future usefulness. And here, I venture to intrude the testimony of my own experience. You see, I often wondered, when I first came to Christ, why I had such a hard time of it when I was coming to the Lord, and why I was so long and so worried in finding a Savior. After that, I wondered why I experienced so many spiritual conflicts while others were in peace. Oh, brethren, I did not know that I was destined to preach to this great congregation, including those of you who are listening to me right now on this radio. I did not understand in those days that I should have to evangelize to hundreds and even thousands of distressed spirits, storm-tossed and ready to perish. But it is so now with me that when the afflicted mention their experience, I can, as a rule, reply saying to them, I have been there. I have been there. And so I can help them as one who has felt the same, beloved. It is meet, therefore, that the young men should bear like the yoke in their youth, and that while they are strong, they should gain experience, not so much for themselves as for others, that in other days, when they come to the fathers, they may be able to help the little ones of the family. Take your tribulation kindly, my brother and my sister. Yes, take it gratefully. Thank your King that he puts you in commission where the thick of the battle centers around you. You will never be a warrior if you never enter the dust clouds where garments are rolled in blood. You will never become a veteran if you do not fight through the long campaign. The man who has been at the head of the fallen hope is he who can tell what stem lightning means. So be it unto you, beloved. May your captain save you from the canker of inglorious case. You must fight in order that you may acquire the character which inspires others with confidence in you and thus fits you to lead your comrades to the fray. Oh, that we may have here an abundance of the young men of the heavenly family who will defend the church against worldliness and error, who will defend the weaker ones from the wolves that prowl around and guard the feeble against the many deceivers that waylay the church of God. If you love the Lord, I charge you, grow in grace and be strong, for we have need of you just now. Oh, my brethren and my sisters, take hold on sword and buckler. Watch and stand fast. May the Lord teach your hands to war and your fingers to fight. In these evil days, may you be as the phalanx to protect our contemporary and the spiritual Israel. The Canaanites, the Hivites, the Hittites and the Jebusites are upon us just now. War is in all our borders. Now therefore, let each valiant man stand about the king's chariot, each man with his sword upon his thigh because of the fear in the night. Thus far have I gone to let you notice the need of strength when John says, you are strong, and you have overcome the wicked one. Now thirdly, the text reminds us of their proof of strength. These young men have overcome the wicked one. Then they must be strong. For a man who can overcome the wicked one is no mean man of war. Write him down among the first three. Beloved, wicked ones abound. But there is one crafty being who deserved the name of the wicked one. He is the acolyte of the rebellion, the first of sinners, the chief of sinners, the tempter of sinners. He is the wicked one who heads assault against the pilgrims of Zion. If any man has ever stood foot to foot with him, he will never forget it. Why? Because it is a fight that once fought will leave its scars, even though the victory be won. Now, in what sense have these young men overcome the wicked one? Please listen. First, in the fact that they have broken right away from his power.
Amen.
Amen.
They were once his slaves. They are not so now.
Mm-hmm.
They once slept beneath his roof in perfect peace, but conscience raised an uproar and the Spirit of God troubled them and they escaped his power.
Right.
Once, Satan never troubled them at all. Why should he? They were good friends together. Now he tempts them and worries them and assaults them because they have left his service. They have engaged themselves to a new master and become the enemies of him who was once their God.
Mm-hmm.
I speak to many who gladly know that not a bit of them now belongs to the devil, from the crown of their head to the sole of their foot. For Christ has bought them body, soul, and spirit with his precious blood, and they have assented to the purchase and feel that they are not their own, and certainly not the devil's, for they are bought with a price and belong to him who purchased them, and that is Jesus.
Amen.
The strong man armed has been turned on it by a stronger than he. Jesus has carried the fortress of the heart by storm and driven out the enemy. Satan is not inside our hearts now. He entered into Judas, but he cannot enter into us now, for our soul is filled by another who is well able to hold his own. The wicked one has been expelled by the Holy One, who now lives and reigns within our nature as Lord of all. Moreover, beloved, these young men have overcome the wicked one, not only in breaking away from his power and in driving him entirely out of possession so that he is no longer master, but they have overcome him in the very fact of their opposition to him. When a man resists Satan, he is victorious over Satan in that very resistance.
Why?
Satan's empire consists in the yielding of our will to his will. But when our will revolts against him, then already we have in a measure overcome him. Although sometimes we are much better at willing than we are at doing, as the Apostle Paul was. For he says, "To will is present within me, but how to perform that which is good, I found not." Yet, beloved, or still I would say, the hate will, to be clean from sin, is a victory over sin. And as that will grows stronger and more determined to resist the temptations of the evil one, in that device we have overcome sin and Satan. What a blessed thing this is for us to fail not to remember that Satan has not weapons of defense, and so when we resist him, he must flee.
Amen.
A Christian man has both defensive and offensive weapons. He has a shield as well as a sword. But Satan has only fiery darts and nothing else. Now, I never read of his having any shield whatever, so that when we resist him, he is bound to run away. He has no defense for himself, and the fact of our resistance is in itself a victory.
Amen.
Amen.
But, my dear brothers and sisters, besides that, some of us who are young men in Christ have won many a victory over Satan. Have we not been tempted? Yes, I mean fearfully tempted. Surely we've been. By the mighty grace of God has come to rescue, and we have not yielded. Can't you look back, not within Pharisaic boasting, but with the gracious exaltation over many evil habits which once had the master over you, but which are master of you no longer? It was a hard conflict. Thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Hear what the Spirit says to you when John writes to you, because you have overcome the wicked one. He says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Once more, beloved, in Christ Jesus, we have entirely overcome the wicked one already. For the enemy we have to contend with is a vanquished enemy. Our Lord and Master met him and destroyed him. He is now destitute of his boasted battle axe, that terrible weapon which has made the bravest men be frightened when they have seen it in his hand. One may ask, what weapon is that, evangelist? Well, that weapon is death. Our Lord overthrew him that has the power of death, and that is the devil. And therefore, Satan has not the power of death any longer. The keys of death and of hell are at the ghetto of Christ Jesus. O you enemy of God's people, we who believe in Jesus shall defeat you, for our Lord defeated you. That bruise upon your head cannot be hidden. Your crown is dashed in pieces. Our Lord has sore wounded you, O dragon, and never can your deadly wound be healed. We have at you with dauntless courage, for we believe the promise of our Lord that he will bruise Satan under our feet shortly. And certainly, as we are bruised under the feet of our crucified Lord, so shall you be bruised under the feet of all his seed to your utter overthrow and contempt. Down with you, Satan. Right, beloved, let us take courage, brothers and sisters, and abide steadfast in the faith, for we have in our Lord Jesus overcome the wicked one. We are more than conquerors through him that has loved us. Now I close with my fourth point, which is about their source of strength. Beloved, you have seen their strength and their need of it and their proof of it. Now let us look for the fountain of it, which is found in these words. The word of God abides in you. The word of God abides in you. My dear hearers, I labor under the opinion that there never was a time in which the people of God had greater need to understand this passage than now. We have entered upon that part of the pilgrim path which may be regarded as the enchanted ground. The church and the world appear to be alike, bewitched with folly. Half the people of God hardly know their head from their heels at this time. They are gaping after wonders, running after sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal, and waiting for yet more astounding inventions. Christians used to believe in Christ as their head and the Bible as their rule. But today, some of them are pleased with lords and rules such as he never knew. Believe me, my brothers and sisters, there will soon come new messiahs. Men are already pretending to work miracles. We shall soon have false Christs, and behold here, behold there, will be head on all sides. Anchors are up, winds are out, and the whole fleet is getting into confusion. Men in whose sanity and stability I once believed are being carried away with one fancy or another, and I'm driven to cry, what next? We are only at the beginning of an era of mingled unbelief and fanaticism. Now we shall know who are God's elect and who are not. For there are spirits abroad at this hour that would, if it were possible, deceive even the very elect. Those who are not deceived are nevertheless sorely put to it. Here is the patience of the saints. Let him look to himself who is not rooted and grounded in Christ, for the hurricane is coming. The signs of the times indicate a carnival of delusions. Many have ceased to be guided by the word and claim to be themselves prophets. Now we shall see what we shall see. Blessed is the sheep that knows its shepherd and will not listen to the voice of strangers. But here is the way to be kept steadfast, beloved. The word of God abides in you. The word of God. That is to say, we are to believe in the doctrines of God's word, and these will make us strong. What vigor they infuse into a man. Beloved, get the word well into you, and you will overcome the wicked one. Keep a fast hold of the doctrines of grace, and Satan will soon give over attacking you. For they are like plate armor, through which no dart can ever force its way. The promises of God's word, too, what power they give a man. To get a hold of a shall and a will in the tune of trouble is a heavenly safeguard. When you say, my God will hear me, or when God say to you, I will not fail you nor forsake you, Oh, beloved, these are divine holdfasts. Oh, how strong a man is for overcoming the wicked one when he has such a promise at hand. My dear hearer, do not trust yourself out of a morning in the street till you have laid a promise under your tongue. I see people put respirators on in foggy weather, especially in America and in Europe. They do not make them look very lovely, but I dare say they are useful. I recommend the best respirator for the pestilential atmosphere of this present evil world when I bid you fit a promise to your lips. Did not the Lord rout the tempter in the wilderness with that promise, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God shall man live"? Oh, beloved, get the promise of God to lodge within you, and you will be strong. Then mind the precepts, for a precept is often a sharp weapon against Satan. Remember how the Lord Jesus Christ struck Satan a killing blow by quoting a precept. It is written, "You shall worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve." If the precept had not been handy, wherewith would the adversary have been rebuked? Nor is the threatening at all a weak weapon. The most terrible threatenings of God's word against sin are the best helps for Christians when they are tempted to sin. How can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? How should I escape if I turned away from him that speaks from heaven? Use the word, beloved, as your sword and shield. There is none like it. Now notice that John not only mentions the word of God, but the word of God in you. You see, the inspired word must be received into a willing mind. How? The book which lies there is to be pleaded here, in the inmost heart, by the work of the Holy Ghost upon the mind. All of this letter, the Bible, is to be translated into spirit and life. The word of God abides in you. That is, first, to know it, next, to remember it and treasure it up in your heart. Following upon this, we must understand it, then learn the analog of faith by comparing spiritual things with the spiritual till we have learned the system of divine truth and more able to set it forth and plead for it. It is next to have the world in your affections, beloved, to love it so that it is as honey or the droppings of the honeycomb to you. When this is the case, you must and shall overcome the wicked one. A man instructed in the scriptures is like an armed knight who, when he goes among the throng, inflicts many wounds but suffers none, for he is locked up in steel. Yes, but that is not all. It is not the word of God in you alone. It is the word of God abiding in you. It is always there. It cannot be removed from you. If a man gets the Bible right into him, he is all right then. Why? Because he is full. In his mind, there is no room for evil. You see, beloved, when you have filled a measure full of wheat, you have effectually shut the chaff out automatically. Men go after novel and false doctrines because they do not really know the truth. For if the truth had gotten into them and filled them, they would not have room for these daydreams. A man who truly knows the doctrines of grace is never removed from them. My dear brother and sister, once you get the truth really into you, it will enter into the texture of your being and nothing will get it out of you. It will also be your strength by setting you watching against every evil thing. You will be on your guard if the word abides in you. For it is written, when you go, it will keep you. Beloved, the word of God will be to you a bulwark, never failing, and a high tower. It will be a case of defense against the foe. Oh, beloved, see to it that the word of God is in your very soul, permitting your thoughts, and so operating upon your outward life, that all may know you to be a true Bible Christian, for they perceive it in your words and deeds. This is the sort of army that we need in the Church of God, beloved. Men who are strong by feeding on God's word. Aspire it, my brethren and my sisters. And when you have reached it, then aspire unto the third degree that you may become fathers in Israel. Up to this measure, at any rate, let us endeavor to advance and advance at once. Are there any here and out there who are not young men in Christ Jesus because they are not in Christ Jesus at all? Oh dear. I cannot speak with you at this hour, for my time is gone, but I am distressed for you. To be out of Christ is such an awful thing that a man had better be out of existence. Without God, without Christ, then you are without joy in life, you are without hope in death. not even a baby in the divine family. They know this, that God shall judge those who are without, and when he comes, how swift and overwhelming will that judgment be? Inasmuch as you would not have Christ in this day, Christ will not have you in that day. My dear brothers and sisters, stay not out of Christ any longer. Seek his face and live. For he who believes in him has everlasting life, the Bible says so. May you be enabled to believe in him at this moment for Jesus' sake. Amen and amen. My dear listener, I trust that the message you have heard was not an entertainment, but a life-saving and life-transforming message for your salvation. This being the case then, you are therefore challenged to be not just a hearer, but a doer of the word. In moments like these, beloved, when the word of God comes to you right into your ears, God has a purpose to let you be a partaker of his blessings. These are rare yet gracious moments for you to think twice and review your spiritual position with your Lord for a decision on where you will spend eternity. If this message has been a blessing to you and you'd like me to remember you in my prayers, please let me know so. Probably today is your first time to hear this message through this radio and you'd like to get in touch with me for more spiritual insights of God's life-saving messages. You are most welcome to contact me. If you've been a regular listener and for this entire long you've been in the valley of decision, but now you say, "Evangelist, enough is enough. I need spiritual transformation with immediate effect by the help of the Holy Spirit." If that is your desire, how I pray therefore that you too may call me for a special prayer so that you may receive that divine power from above to seal your decision and walk uprightly in righteousness. My brother, my sister out there, probably it is your decision now that having wandered away from Jesus for so long, so many years, as a backslider, you need now to slide back to Jesus. Or if all this long you've been a nominal Christian, meaning one in name only, and now you need to be baptized and join God's church, which is his gateway to heaven, but you do not know as yet where to get help for your subsequent baptism, please call me today. To some of you, our regular members, who need special prayers in your Christian walk of life, or even for the cares of this life, you too call me. Your call will be private, and God will answer you and grant your desires in accordance with his loving kindness, the multitude of his tender mercies, and according to his timing. Please call me today or send me a short text message to that effect. If you are in Tanzania, I am reachable through Voda 0767, Airtel 0784, Tigo 0715. The number is 314-629. I repeat, Voda 0767, Airtel 0784, Tigo 0715. The number is 314-629. For regional and international listeners outside Tanzania, please call me on plus 255-784-314-629 or plus 255-767-314-629 and you'll be connected. For now, stay tuned and remain blessed. Until then, bye-bye.
Yesterday is gone forever. You've got today to make up your mind. Don't say tomorrow, it may be too late for salvation. And yesterday is gone forever, you've got today to make up your mind.
Some faint voice is calling, calling from far away. Why don't you answer? For the voice is so sweet.
It is the Savior standing calling, calling you to come home.
Oh, come home, you poor sinner. Calling, don't miss this chance. Don't say tomorrow, it may be too late for salvation.